are complementing one another, and they are all needed for our nation to become a big power in near future. So this was just to do it. You can double click. Just 5 minutes I'll take, this video will take. So it showed end to end what was happening, what I mentioned. Yes. So this was on 26th April, early mornings, 5:30, 5:40 a.m. So some of us were there in Sriharikota. So it was launched from Sriharikota launch range. And as I mentioned, it was one of the heaviest satellite. First time so much weight was being carried by this PSLV satellite in its last 25 years of service. And this all our director, Dr. Kiran Kumar, our ISRO chairman. Voice is there?
Voice?
No?
The mic will have kept there.
So there is a viewing gallery there where this say, launch is some 3 kilometers away in that island, and we have this control center which is almost 3 kilometers from that particular.
Level system, satellite, ground stations, which monitor the flight events and several other ground stations. At T-minus 14, which the ignition of the
15 seconds.
Launch vehicle will start with the roll control thrusters, reaction control thrusters.
10,
it'll be
9,
followed by.
So this is the launch center, launch tower, and we were sitting at the launch center from where it is all commanded. Now it goes into auto mode. Now there is no control.
ये आप देख सकते हैं धुएं की लकीर पीछे छूटता हुआ एक और सफलता इसरो के नाम और आवाज की आप सुन पा रहे होंगे
See, this is no different from other launches. Every launch goes this way. But what is different is coming now. After that, the detachment of the satellite and then putting into, as I mentioned, that solar panels and that antenna deployment, that was a major thing.
उसे उपट ली गई है इस समय जो चतुर चरण है वो
सेटेलाइट बट द मेन थिंग एज आई मेंशन ओपनिंग ऑफ सोलर पैनल गेटिंग दैट सिग्नल नाउ दिस इज व्हाट वाज हैपनिंग एट ईस्ट्रेक बेंगलोर. When we switched off the payload, we have that payload, that mimic we call it, it pictorial representation. So these many subsystems, as I mentioned, around 1400 subsystems, how they are behaving. I have given a power on command now for that payload, radar sensor. So everything has appeared green now. Then it will go into actual mapping. Now when mapping is happening, it will flash like this. So 5 to 6 minutes it will map. And then again it will switch off once a system one by one. So again that information, so what command I am sending, whether it is happening properly or not, that feedback I get through telemetry, and then accordingly we change all the colors so that person sitting and commanding from ground at ISTREC Bangalore, that is our satellite tracking and telecommand center, he knows everything, he can visualize pictorially. So this was also first time being attempted in all our missions, and now it is a regular feature of all the missions. So that there is, otherwise people have to debug that total data stream which comes in the computer and try to find out what is happening where and all that as offline analysis. But this in real time we can get all the information. And this was happening at Bangalore. Now I'll show you what was happening parallelly at Hyderabad, where actual radar image data was coming or signal. So after doing that mapping, it has switched it off. So we know its status. Yeah, even if say one thing remains green, then it is a cause of worry. Now, this is what was happening in real time at Hyderabad. So I have given that mapping command, when it was flashing, it was doing mapping. At that time, that whole image of the area where it was imaging is coming in real time. As I mentioned, it will appear like snow if you don't process it properly. But here the total image, I have put some Bombay images also. So in real time, all these images come at Hyderabad, and person sitting there at Hyderabad know the status that whole radar is functioning properly. These are some images I have put of your Bombay area also. These are real-time images. Further, we collect this data and process it offline also on big computers, supercomputers, where you generate more precision images. This is your total Bombay area. So immediately we know that everything is working properly. So that whole, this is how that I am trying to convey that how a project of such big magnitude has been conceived and then executed, and everything worked in tandem in a proper fashion. Just it will take 2 minutes more. Then after 4 days, Prime Minister called our delegation, people who are involved in that, some around 25, all of us went there along with our chairman ISRO to Prime Minister's office, and we had around 45 minutes discussion with him, explaining all the things. These are some images which. So thank you very much for your attention. And if you have any query. So as I mentioned, I'm notorious for exceeding my time limit everywhere. So please
but
pardon me.
Can ask some couple of questions we can.
Yeah,
ask.
Sure, we'll take that.
Any I am
more a technologist rather than a scientist. So, but I'll try to answer all your questions.
Yes, ma'am. Mike.
Yeah, please.
Hello.
Yes, madam.
It was really an exciting lecture. Just since beginning, I was thinking on one, if Google Map gives you all the images to that minute level, then what is the necessity of we launching this project for that application?
Yeah.
You showed the comparative images, but it was a passing note. So could you please elaborate on that?
Yeah, Google images, see, they are not collected in real time. See, this is being done on a regular basis. They try to get information from some area through various camera images and then put it on the screen. Here, as I mentioned, there are a lot of applications like change detection, and then on a regular basis, say, on your border areas or some particular area of interest, like this Ravi crop monitoring or Kharif crop monitoring, and all these are regular seasonal activities which are being required to be done on a regular and a routine basis. So for that, you need operational satellite series only. Google fellow cannot go all the time during the particular time. Even satellites are, even we are facing problems with satellite because you need to have a constellation of satellites to have, say, 1 day repeativity or 2 day repeativity. Here in, say, in every 14 or 20 days only, I can go to same area again, even with satellites. Then you can imagine a person on ground going to all the different places in the world to collect that information. And India is a very vast country. If it is only a small place like Singapore and all, you can manage with your Google Maps everything. And there are plethora of applications, different variety of applications.
Yeah, there is a question.
So my name is Virendra.
You can stand up.
Hello. Yeah, my name is Virendra. So I just wanted to know, like, I have heard about geosynchronous satellites. So what exactly is geosynchronous satellites and how different it is from geostationary and other satellites?
Yeah, see, what I was explaining here, remote sensing satellite, mostly they are all low Earth orbit or LEO satellites. Okay, so they will operate at a range of, say, 400 kilometers up to 1,000 kilometers. Their main orbit, that is altitude from Mars surface, will be in the range of 400 to 1,000 kilometers, and it will move generally from north to south. So Earth is moving beneath that. Satellite is anyway moving north to south only. So it is covering different areas of the Earth. Now, what is happening in geosynchronous or geostationary satellite, it is at 36,000 kilometer height. And that orbit is such that, and it appears stationary with respect to Earth. Only some minor correction, it will form pattern of eight sort of thing, which needs fuel to correct that trajectory. With a minor thruster firing, we can do that correction. So it appears stationary from Earth. That's why they are called geostationary satellites. So from physics, we can derive that at 36,000 kilometer, we'll have orbit such that movement of the satellite and movement of Earth, say Earth has a almost 1 kilometer per second or that sort of speed at equator. So that will match with that movement of that satellite. So everything will appear stationary. So when I want to have communication links, basically, or navigational links, for that they are useful. Because they will appear, I won't need to cover a fixed area only, you know, for communication, if everything is moving, then Doppler will come into picture. And that will, you need to do correction for that. So from that angle, geostationary satellite is required for all communication satellite-related activities. And now navigation satellite also we have put in almost similar orbit, although navigation can be done in different ways, like GPS as a medium Earth orbit type of location.
There is one question there. Can someone give the mic there?
Sir, it's just a curiosity. I just wanted to know how far our Mars mission would be differently accomplished from the other countries that have achieved.
Yeah, that question is a valid question. As recently Curiosity was in news from last August onwards, when it was Mars Space Science Laboratory was landed on the Mars surface. So as such, nothing will be different. Only, as I mentioned, mastering the technology. If you want to achieve that Mars orbit, and as I mentioned, out of almost 19 or 20 missions, almost more than half have failed. So what will be our success in that, and what will be, because as in future, as I mentioned, Mars, if it is going to be a habitable planet in future, we need to master it. It is like that Antarctica going, say everybody has gone, why we should also go there? But we go there because now, right now no rules apply there, and whosoever corners whatever area, it is his area. So something similar may happen on Mars also, once it becomes habitable. But basically to acquire, if we want to become a leader of the world, superpower or whatever we have aspirations, to achieve that we need to have a cutting edge technology and that acquisition. So basic driving force is that.
What are we going to do with the abandoned satellites? Because once the program is over,
yeah,
somewhere in one of the seminars, somebody said that we are going to generate energy for future
applications. Yeah, that is called space debris. That is a major problem worldwide. So you have an international, there is a forum where space debris related discussions are regularly being held. Normally what happens is LEO orbit satellites and all, once that fuel is over or some satellite develops some malfunctioning, anyway it is being abandoned. And we try to give that command while it is still having some life, that its orbit is to be lowered in such a way, if it comes below, say, 200 or 190, that sort of orbit, automatically it will burn out and disappear. That is one way. Another thing is raising the orbit and put it into what we call a parking orbit, where it doesn't affect others, actual live satellite, which we will be launching in future also. So these are few techniques which are being used. But some satellite which disintegrate, that again is a bigger problem. So you cannot explode it and disintegrate, because that any small part also moving at that very high speed can cause damage to any of the live satellite system. So it is, of course, it is a big problem, and there are agencies working on that to work out different methodologies to solve this problem. But till now that traffic is not that much that it become a traffic problem of, say, Bombay or Bangalore. Right now, it's still manageable.
Another thing is that when we are launching these Chandrayaan and all, are we concentrating on some mineral exploration and all kinds of things, oil exploration or some kind of things along with these satellite programs? because that potential areas where we are going to have.
Yeah, that is one idea. If future habitat is going to be there on Moon, we need all sort of activities to be done there. So one is finding water. So one major aim was water, because that last Chandrayaan 1 mission, it generated a lot of curiosity and interest, because some water molecules, NASA also reported, some of our PRL colleagues also reported, they have got enough evidence of some hydroxyl molecules and all that. But there is a far way to go from hydroxyl to H2O. But that is one area. Then other is geomorphical mapping or geological mapping. And in future, if we want to do mining on Moon and all that, find out different areas where potential minerals exist. So that also, different sensors are being put to do that analysis also. And other side of the Moon is being explored with now radar sensor, which was not possible till now with our earlier mission. So all this data has a variety of application here.
I think there will be many more questions, but we'll take last question from Professor Patil and one from AVU.
Okay, my question is for the agriculture.
Yeah.
We are facing the problem of water resources.
Hmm.
So can we combine active signals, passive signals, and the earth signals to find out what are the where are the water resources? And then we can use some kind of theory by means of which we can have the internal mapping. We can have the network theory used for the same. But do we have that kind of data where the water resources, maybe dam or any other thing, river origin and so on?
Yeah, one application what we were looking at, when, as I mentioned, this radar satellite itself, microwave will be useful in one of these application areas, because that time when we were configuring, we were discussing with agriculturists or our agriculture application scientists. So their priority or their emphasis was that we should go for L-band radars system, where it is, as you go to lower and lower frequency, it will have a more penetrating power to a subsurface level. So that is one area that is what we call soil moisture analysis, which is very useful for agriculture, our crop yield prediction and all that thing also, as well as you mentioned, if some of that moisture gets by measuring on a subsurface level, although that penetration won't be very deep, but based on that information which you collect at a subsurface level, some sort of penetration, I can find out the location of some of the water resources, how deep it has gone. Because what problem we are facing is, it is that water table is going down and down. Otherwise, water is there everywhere. But some areas or the drought-prone areas, their water table, there is too much excavation. Water is going down, the table is going down. So from this soil moisture analysis, that is one way which I feel can be looked into that. And there is other thing is ocean salinity. That is also being monitored with, again, this type of L-band system. But one problem recently was reported while measurement of soil moisture and ocean salinity. There was one SMOS mission from European Space Agency that since all these mobile signals and all, they used to corrupt whatever sensor has been put. So you don't know whether that signal which is coming through this mobile communication, that is corrupting the signal actually which was desired to be monitored from the satellite. So all this, that's why we have what you call frequency regulation, so that you other each one application is allocated different frequencies in which they have to work, so that they don't contradict or confuse with each other. But still, as I mentioned, it still is a nascent stage. And apart from as far as water table and other things concerned, you have to do ground truth measurement only. But one indirect way could be the soil moisture analysis, because we can, using a L-band radar system, we can do soil moisture measurement very efficiently from satellite. Yeah, data is available. See, we have a Japanese LOS mission, which was L-band SAR, and now ISRO is planning a L-band radar after this RISAT-1. Next mission we have planned is a L-band radar. It is still under proposal stage, because if government approves that, it will be taken up as a next mission. That will be still much bigger satellite than this, because that antenna here was 6 meter by 2 meter. It will be 10 meter by 3 meter. So you can imagine it's linked, interlinked. But L-band SAR is on our priority. If not there, then we are also working on a joint mission with our American scientists, with a NASA scientist. So they also have some proposal for a joint L-band and S-band mission, which could materialize.
Well, I think your talk has generated a lot of interest. There is a question from NES Ratnam College. Since we are on AVU webcasting live, There is a question that why all these satellites are covered with either silver or golden sheets.
Yeah, we have what we call MLI, that is multi-level insulators. So that will insulate from that radiation affecting some of the electronics and other material which are being used in the satellite. So that golden sheet you see is a MLI cover which is being put to take care of radiation. Then we have aluminum shield also to take care of radiation effects like total dose or single event upsets. Although single event upset is not still, we cannot manage that because once in a while, due to the bombardment of neutrons and all these heavy ions, your circuit may malfunction. So either you have to use a radiation-hardened devices. So quality of device and all, anyway, that is being taken care of. But over and above that multi-level insulator, what is that yellow sheet what is mentioning, that is being used to have a proper thermal management of the total system. Because as I mentioned, it goes through a cycle of this thing. So some of the portions exposed there outside, like antenna and other things, they have to work in all satellite systems where telemetry or telecommand antenna are there because command I'm sending, that has to be received by antenna and then it will go inside the satellite through other means, through cables and all. But before that, this has to survive temperature effects. So that total temperature from minus 55 to plus 125 degrees centigrade, the total range it has to meet, it has to work flawlessly over this total temperature range. And to maintain the thermal equilibrium also, you have to work out the total thermal management system in satellite. So all these are parts of the requirements which are there to take care in the thermo-vacuum condition in which the satellite is operating in this space.
I think we'll close the interactive session. If you have any questions, you can ask outside. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Now, Professor Kothari will be proposing the vote of thanks formally.
Well, before I propose the vote of thanks, to announcements. One is that we have this competition for students who listen to these lectures. They should send a report to us by email, and we will it will be reviewed by the judges, and then prizes will be announced. In last six lectures that we have had, there were only 7 entries, and therefore we did not announce any prize, but. Their names will be announced who have submitted their entries. They should submit to us by email called eyes2013.mu@gmail.com. I think that was displayed earlier. Yeah, these are the students who had submitted their entries. And let's thank those students at least, and let's give them the big hand that they had submitted. But this is too small number, and then we require at least for each lecture at least 10 so that we can announce the prizes. The second announcement is about the next lecture. We will have next three lectures or four lectures, but the next Saturday's lecture is not yet finalized. Whom do we invite because of some clashing of dates? But it will appear on internet on Tuesday morning, and please do come. After that, we have a lecture by Dr. Chidambaram on 30th March. 6th April, we'll have Dr. Mulchand Sharma, and the last lecture we'll have on 13th April will be by Dr. Professor Nalikar. Professor Nalikar is the last lecture. So I invite all of you to all these lectures. Please come in large numbers. Otherwise, this series will not have any meaning because it's meant for you, all of you. With this, I come to the last formality. It is an honor and privilege to be called upon to present the word of thanks. I'd like to first thank Dr. K. Radhakrishnan, who could not come, but he tried his best, and then he asked Dr. Kiran Kumar to come, but he also was busy. And then we have Dr. Nilesh M. Desai. Thank you very much for your so interesting lecture that it has generated a lot of questions, and we have we are about almost half an hour late, delayed in closing the ceremony, and that shows that he has, you know, generated a lot of interest. And in fact, after listening to this lecture, I feel proud to be an Indian that we have such a good space program. And I'd like to, let's give him a big hand again, Dr. Nilesh Desai. Of course, I'd like to thank the authorities, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. Rajan Velukar, Dr. Naresh Chandra, who are present today, and also Dr. Rajpal Hande, who is behind this organization of these lectures, and the registrar and his big team, who is helping us administratively, Dr. Kumar Khare and his team, and GAD. But this program cannot happen with the team efforts of the faculty members, volunteer students, and administrative staff. It's a big name, big team. We have Professor Srivara Mangai from IT department for comparing. Professor Srivara Mangai from IT department and her team who has designed these banners. The team members are Subodh Devlekar, Nikhil Pavnikar, Prakash Vishwakarma, Prakash Kadam, Santosh Shingade, Nitesh Tetiguri, and Swadesh Chinkate. So these are the people who have worked behind the screen, so let's thank them. Then Dr. Dongrayan of Biophysics, who is managing the stage and the PowerPoint presentation. And his team members are Nitesh Kunte, Vaibhav Patil, who are sitting here, Sagar Khanwilkar. And every time one or two members are missing, but he has another two or three members who always help us. Dr. Josna Dongardive of Computer Science Department, her team helps in registration and, you know, receiving these competition entries. And her team members are Chinmay, Dipesh, Bhumit, Bilal, Aniket, Srikant, Yogesh, Sneha, Rupali, and Nikita, large number, and then they help us in organizing this. Dr. Ambuja Salgaonkar, she reviewed the entries, competition entries, and I think next session, next Saturday, she may tell us, give us the feedback. Today, we do not have time for her. So thank you very much, Dr. Ambuja Salgaonkar. Then we have Dr. Kishore Gayakwad and Dr. Gowli and Sri Mohan Kumar from the Lifelong Learning Department. We have Vinod Malale, PRO, with us. And from General Administration, we have a team of Sri Gosavi, Saman Madam, BCA Madam, Ramesh Bhimani, who is always with us, DS Kamle, Dutta Maukar, Pramod Fonde, and Jay Singh Solanki, who, you know, manage this cleaning and arranging the stage and arranging this hall. University engineers, engineering section, Yogesh and Sharad, who look after this mic. Account section, who are there to help us in the funding, etc. Physics department, we have Abhijit Bogle and Kiran Londe today, but we have many other students who help us. So we thank all the students volunteers with us, all the students who took part in competition and participation. Thank you. Thank to all of you who have come today and witnessed this proud presentation of our space journey. I also like to thank, if I have forgotten someone, let's stand for the national anthem and then we sing together national anthem.
Janagana mana adinayaka jaya he bharat bhagya vidata. Punjab, Sindh, Gujarat, Maratha, Dravid, Utkal, Banga, Vindhya, Himachal, Yamuna, Ganga, Uchal, Jaladi, Taranga. Tava Shubh Name Jaage, Tava Shubh Aashish Maage, Gaahe Tava Jaya Gatha. जन गण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता जय हे